All right. Hi, everybody. Thanks for joining. This is the December session of the Journal Club series. Today's topic is orthopedic injuries. We'll have a couple of journal articles. I believe there's three in total. And then we have some volunteers to go over how to create splints using a SAM splint, which is like a preformed splint material, as well as how to do some improvised sling management. Sorry. I just saw the little baby with the helmet. So whoever feels first, take it away. I think Drew Joseph, let's have Joseph go last. He's got some stuff that he wants to show at the end. Saram, do you feel comfortable taking it off, taking the lead?
Yeah, I have to leave for a shift also on an hour, so I'll probably start.
Perfect. Let's have you go first.
Awesome. So I think you need to enable screen sharing.
Make sure. There you go.
So hello, everyone. My name is Sriram. I'm currently a fourth year medical student. My topic is field management of displaced ankle fractures. Okay, why is it not working? Okay. So the author of the article is Dr. Brian Dean from St. Louis University. I've included a QR code just in case if anyone wants to scan the article to follow along. Proceeding to the next slide. So the general anatomy of the ankle, just wanted to give you guys a brief overview. So it consists of the tibia, fibula, and the talus. Tibia forms the superior medial aspects. Fibula is the lateral aspect. There's a cube-shaped bone that sits just about the calcaneus, and that's called a talus. And distal ends of the fibula and tibia kind of overlap with the talus, and that's known as the malleoli. So talking points that's going to be discussed today is overview of just displaced ankle fractures, initial evaluation, normal ED management, the proposed treatment technique, which is described by the author, and a short conclusion. So overview of displaced ankle fractures, orthopedic trauma, as we all know, is about the most common subset of injuries faced in the wilderness. Although it's not really life-threatening, initial treatment and subsequent management is really critical to improve quality of life for months and years to come. Mostly seen in patients or persons over 55 years of age, cause you to slip and fall and awkward landings. Most common symptoms are very severe pain and inability to weight bear. So initial evaluation, I think most of us should be pretty familiar with this. Follow HLS protocols, make sure that the patient is hemodynamically stable and also in a cardiopulmonary standpoint, and do a more focused examination of his affected lower extremity to see if there's any obvious deformities or soft tissue swellings, and then do a more thorough neurovascular examination, mostly looking for his distal pulses, especially posterior tibial and dorsalis pedis pulses. And one thing to consider is the time to a definitive care facility. If the time is below 2 hours, it's still recommended to transport the patient to the nearest care facility. But if it's more than 2 hours, then anatomic reduction in the wilderness is recommended. So normal ED management. So the top reasons why we would do an anatomic reduction would be to release the compression and tension on your vascular structures. In most cases, this restores regular blood flow. Also, it decreases the chances of articular damage from friction from jagged bone edges. And also one other thing most common is the pain levels, edema and inflammation, which is usually increased in dislocation and fractures. And this kind of, when you set the bone or ankle back into place, it usually reduces significantly. So to achieve an anatomic reduction in the ED, normal stuff, IV access is established. Patients usually sedated with high level of anesthesia under the care from trained emergency physician. And then the physician manipulates the ankle to achieve near complete reduction. And then the patient is advised to follow with orthopedic surgery. But in the wild, you do not have those options. Most of those resources are rare. So the author in this article talks about a special technique called hematoma block, where he explains that 1% lidocaine, about 2 to 2.5 milligrams per kg, is injected into the ankle. He says two landmarks, which is tibialis anterior tendon and then the medial malleolus. So the injection point would be halfway between them. Author just says that once it's injected in, reduction can be safely done. Patient will feel no pain, just a little amount of axial traction, and then just pop the ankle back into place, can be easily done. The technique is fully minimally invasive. It's very effective. And most of the materials, which is not too much, just needle supplies, is available in most expedition kits. So there's no rarity of the supply. So there's no special equipment which is needed. So what if it doesn't work? If reduction is not possible, or after several attempts, it is not achievable, then the quick release traction method can always be used. Basically, it's not too much of a problem. It's basically the lower extremity or the leg, which is dislocated, is suspended, leg out by the toes. Any long socks or underwear can be used to tie the leg out suspended about 20 to 40 minutes. And this causes, multiple studies have proved that this causes axial internal pressures, which kind of push everything back into place and it within 20 to 40 minutes. So this can always be done. So conclusion, with more people getting out in the outdoors and wilderness, pain management in the outdoors and austere environments is going to be really critical. And this technique of the hematoma block, which is demonstrated by the author, is really ideal, I would say, with not too many new materials or medications needed. It's lidocaine is pretty common, can be done by anyone, as long as you're kind of certified in wilderness medicine. And if all techniques fail, manual reduction using quick release maneuver can always be done to put everything back into place. And that's it. So those are my references. And thank you. Have any questions? I can answer.
Does anybody have a point they want to make or any input on this article?
Yeah, thanks, Sharon. That was well done. I think so. I'm most of you probably haven't ever met me or seen me. I'm Ryan Eggers. I was a wilderness medicine fellow, resident elective a couple of years ago, and I'm an orthopedic trauma surgeon. So I was asked to jump on this call just because it's orthopedic trauma. Quigley's is really helpful. A lot of times down in the trauma bay, I'd reduce a ankle fracture. You can also hang them just by the toes. You don't necessarily have to immobilize the entire leg. One thing to remember when you're doing ankle fractures is that often they will either go medially or laterally. So if they go medially, then the intact buttress is laterally. So you push it back laterally. So you basically want to put it back where it goes, which seems elementary, but you never realize how much of that you lose in the heat of the moment. So if it looks like, and you could always compare to the other side. That's the thing to remember when you're facing somebody with a weird looking ankle, just compare it to the other side. Just see what the other side looks like. If the foot is off medially, that means the medial malleolus has broken off, but the lateral malleolus is still more or less intact, you can at least assume. So you want to push it back laterally. And so you kind of, that's the orientation you want to apply your pressure towards. So again, seems kind of elementary, but pushing it back into the direction of the intact buttress. So if it's sticking out laterally, the medial malleolus is a really nice area for the talus to pop back into. And if you let the foot, if you hang by the big toe and the foot will fall into some external rotation or eversion, then the talus will pop back into the medial malleolus, and that's actually really nice and strong. And then you can apply your splint while they're hanging in the Quigley's traction. So those are kind of my two cents for how to evaluate and immobilize these. And the hematoma block is pretty effective. I didn't do it as often because down in the ED, we usually just use sedation because it's easier, but for distal radiuses and a couple of times I did the hematoma block for ankles and yeah, it's pretty effective. So if you throw some lidocaine and a needle in your kit, you'll be pretty well set.
Awesome. Thank you.
Yeah, I found myself using hematoma blocks more lately during COVID. With so few nurses, it's hard to find a room to do a sedation in nowadays. So I grab a nurse and I just get a vial of lidocaine and I run off and do a hematoma block, and it buys me time. It's a significant pain reliever. And then this patient just hangs out in the hallway waiting for a bed to do a sedation if needed. So whether it's just for time or you're doing it for actual reduction, it is very helpful. Oh, we have a video, Sriram?
Oh, that's not me.
Oh, that's not you?
That's not me.
And I'm sorry I didn't introduce our guest today. We have Dr. Eggers from St. George, Utah, and we have Dr. Eilis from Nevada joining.
I'll chime in there. It sounds like, I don't know if anyone else had sound on that, but I didn't, but it's great. Quigley maneuver, I agree with Dr. Eggers. It's a great maneuver to have in your back pocket when you need it. It works great. I've done it in the field and in the ER, and actually done it on sidelines as well. I'm a sports medicine physician. So I've done it, and it works wonderfully when you need it to work. I also will state the hematoma block is the way to go. Back in the old days when I trained, that was kind of what we did for almost everything. And then that kind of went out of fashion. There's a lot of orthopedists that will tell you, or even ER physicians, different individuals, they'll tell you don't do it because then you convert a closed fracture to an open fracture. But in a wilderness scenario, I don't care, right? At that point, we're talking about long-term extrications, right? You know, when we talk about hematoma blocks and being, shouldn't we do it? Usually those are discussions that happen inside an ER off or ER room, or maybe an orthopedic office where there's lots of resources available to you and there's different options and you want to choose which one works best for you. So, I mean, I agree with Justin in that, you know, hey, you don't have a nursing resource, hematoma block works great. And you should get down there and do it. Don't ever be afraid. From my personal point of view, my opinion is don't ever be afraid to do a hematoma block. It works wonderfully. I've done it even on football players that have fractures. I've done it with different teams where we've gone across state lines or even across international lines, and you're not really allowed to use narcotics or other pain medications. And so I'll take some 2% lidocaine, or even a longer acting anesthetic, and I'll go ahead and use a hematoma block for someone during a flight so that we can actually get them back and then take care of it in an appropriate fashion. You pack it and splint it. And I think Dr. Ayers, great, great comment on put your splint on when they're hanging in the Quigley. So much easier to do that if you have that option. And then what you do with the splint at that point, you know, once you kind of get it on, a lot of times just the splint itself is tremendously helpful in handling sort of the pain management sort of aspect of the fracture. Once they're splinted, and it really does well. And even just a SAM splint that's well padded and well placed can really provide a lot of pain relief. So just kind of keep those things in mind. My two cents.
Before we move on to the next article, I had a quick question for both of you. So it mentioned in the article, the indications for field reduction are obviously neurovascular compromise and or 2 hours to like extrication. Either of you really feel strongly about the timeline?
No, I mean, if I got a call when I was on call and said, hey, somebody tried to put it back in place, who knew what they were doing, I would not be upset at all. Like, even if they're, you know, up in Zion, which is like an hour away from where I'm at now. And, you know, to me, it's sort of like, it's not quite as bad as shoulders, and we'll get to shoulders, but in terms of how much more difficult reduction gets after a prolonged period of time, I haven't noticed that it makes a big difference the longer they're out. Mostly because once they get to the hospital, we can just knock them out anyways, but pain wise makes a big difference. Swelling wise, I think makes a big difference. So I would say, unless you're in the parking lot of the ER with an ankle fracture and you know what you're doing, just put it back in place.
I agree.
Be rigid on that. I'm muted.
No, I agree completely with that. Yeah. I think, I'm always trying to think about, you know, trying to make the patient more comfortable during transport. And that's the one. Two, it's always going to be the easiest moments, the simplest moment to put it back in place is going to be the moment after it dislocates, or the moment after it's distracted, or the moment it's actually that the incident has already happened. On the field is going to be easiest. And I can tell you time and time again, from both playing field and both out in the wilderness, that, you know, if I'm looking at something and I see it dislocate or I see something happen, the reduction is so much easier if I do it right then and there than if, you know, the old, well, we're going to pack and ship. And then, you know, you think, well, we're only 30 minutes from town, but then you forget we got to walk down there and it's going to get cleared and then they go through town, but then there's, you know, avalanche or it's snowing or whatever. There's always something that makes it longer than you think. Oh, it's only 30 minutes. 3 hours later, you know, they drive into the parking lot and you're sitting there going, what happened? Right. So always reduce it. I agree. So if you're not in the parking lot outside the ER, reduce it.
Yeah. And one more thing that I actually kind of wish they'd mentioned in this article was open fracture, which is if you don't reduce, let's say you have a closed injury, but you have skin tension, if either a bony edge or even the intact medial malleolus can cause a lot of skin pressure, within a couple of hours, that can turn into an open fracture. I can also tell you that surgically repairing an ankle that's been dislocated for a while is a pain, because where you need to make your incisions for fixation can be ruined by skin. So always respect the skin, especially around the ankle. And that is another huge reason to reduce acutely rather than stabilizing in place, is because you can actually, if you stabilize it in the wrong position, you can turn a closed fracture into an open fracture, which is a problem. So I think all signs basically point to put it back in place.
Hey, sorry, I had a quick question about that. So let's say extrication is like approximately an hour, but multiple attempts at manual reduction fail. Would you suggest doing like a Quigley then, if it could take up to 40 minutes, or would you suggest just immediate extrication?
So I would say by the time, just from a practical standpoint, by the time you call and things arrive and people figure out what's going on, you could probably at least try the Quigleys. So yeah, I would say if multiple reduction attempts haven't been successful, just hang them in Quigleys until the extrication arrives. Yeah, I don't think you're going to make anything worse by doing that.
Cool, thanks.
Any other questions on ankles? Hey, one of our students volunteered to show how to do splinting for ankle fractures. Becca, do you have all your stuff?
I do, yes. My dog is not going to help, unfortunately. Okay, so the first one is going to be the stirrup one. So you would want to do this on the patient's leg that's not their hurt leg first, just to kind of form your SAM splint. So I'm assuming everyone knows what a SAM splint is already, but they're the closed cell foam with the malleable aluminum in them. They're pretty easy. They're really lightweight, and they're really flimsy until you add a bend into them, which is when they gain their strength. So on their not hurt ankle, you would want to wrap it kind of around the bottom of the foot up like this, and then kind of mold it around their leg so that it fits and you get the bend and adding the stability in there. And then once you do that, you transfer it to their good leg, which I probably didn't need to do that, but. And then you would just kind of wrap it either with ACE wrap or whatever you have. I have this. Honestly, I don't know what it is, but whatever this is called.
Looks like blue Coban to me.
Yes, whatever it's called. I've got green too. And then you just wrap it. You don't want it to be too tight, but you do want to keep the ankle stable, and you want to keep the ankle at a, I think the ankle is supposed to be at 90 degrees when you splint it, if it's possible to do so. And then you just keep going around. And you can also leave their shoe on, especially if it's cold outside, and that can act to help brace the ankle as well. But then it's nice and stable that way. You can't really move as much. So it kind of helps and prevents them from moving that and making that worse. And then,
well, she gets prepared for the other version. I just wanted to mention real quick, if you have any concern for neurovascular compromise, try and leave some access to pulses. Or if you do any procedure and you're gonna have a long extrication, I recently had a patient with, I was really concerned for compartment syndrome, and the orthopedic surgery resident didn't leave any windows in the splint to check pulses or check any signs. So if you've heard from medical school, the P's of concern for compartment syndrome. So I had the other resident come down, redo the splint, and have some windows put in. And of course the pressures were like 29, 28, 27. I was like, oh, we're going to be monitoring this guy. So just leave some access. Don't wrap it up so tight that there, or never wrap it up tight, but don't tidy it up so well you can't actually assess anything.
Yes, thank you. I forgot to add that part in there. I also was, I should have noted that if the patient does have feeling, you want to let them, and they're awake and alert, tell them to let you know if they notice any change in sensation or tingling or anything like that that's going on while they're while the extrication is going on. So the other one that you can do is a short leg splint. So instead of doing the stirrup, which goes up the sides of the legs, this one's going to be more of a posterior splint. So again, you use their good leg, and it kind of just goes on their foot like a boot. And you fold it down, kind of shape it around. And again, you don't want it to be too tight. And this kind of just helps, again, with the stability of the ankle. And then you would just start at the top and kind of wrap down again. And like that. This is harder to do on yourself than on another person. And yeah, there you go. And then again, you can leave their boot on, and especially if it's cold outside, and then check for pulses and everything, make sure it's nice and stable. And then there you go.
Make sure you use plenty of padding under any of these splints.
Yes. Especially if you're using anything that's not a SAM splint too, which has a little bit of padding, but you would want more as well.
Where do you recommend checking for a pulse, or do you just recommend checking circulation at the toes?
I would recommend leave a little space across the dorsum of the foot, just above the arch for the dorsalis pedis. But remember that some people don't have it. I think the number I usually quote is about 20% of people don't actually have a dorsalis pedis pulse. So don't freak out necessarily. But 90% of people or 80% of people do. So, and then the other one would be the posterior tib behind the medial malleolus, which can be hard to find, especially if it's swollen. So the dorsalis pedis is usually the most reliable. But honestly, if you can't find a dorsalis pedis, especially if it's swollen, brisk cap refill in any or all of the toes is, in my book, enough for an austere environment. You don't have to waste a bunch of time trying to find the dorsalis pedis. I have trouble finding it sometimes in patients who have no neurovascular injury. So don't waste a ton of time. I think you can usually find the right across the dorsum of the foot.
Cool, thank you.
Is there somewhere else you should be specifically looking to check for it? If they leave their shoe on, then, or does it just like the next closest?
Yeah, unfortunately, if the shoe's still on, any neurovascular injury is almost guaranteed to be at the level of the injury. So you're going to find a problem distal to that. And so with an ankle fracture, if the shoe's on, you're not really going to be able to assess the pulse. If you want to cut the toes out of the shoe so you can see the toes and check brisk refill there, I guess you could. But Or one thing you could do too is if you cut the laces, move the tongue of the shoe out of the way. Then you can usually feel the dorsalis pedis right across the top of the shoe that way.
Cool. Thanks for the demonstration. And anything else on ankles before we move to some articles on shoulders? There's so many areas of the body we could have focused on. I decided to kind of focus on some big areas here. Wrists, of course, would have been high yield too, but we can do that at the end if anybody's interested. So Drew, do you feel comfortable to go next? Go ahead.
So piggybacking right off that, time from the insult is shorter time, much easier to take care of. I'm going to piggyback right off it. My sound's working, right? Great.
Yes.
I accidentally gave an explanation once for about 10 minutes where I realized I was muted. It was great. So piggybacking right off the shorter time between the insult and the reduction being easier is this interesting review on a, they use the term non-medical for the ski patrollers, as in the ski patrollers who do not have, they specifically said, a registered nurse, a paramedic, a advanced provider, a physician who happens to be on the mountain who also works ski patrol or who's willing to do a reduction. But this was for the, as they term, non-medical ski patrollers to be able to do a closed reduction on an anterior shoulder dislocation. The study they were doing was, where they were studying this was a remote ski ground in Canada, where it was going to be on a optimistic day, at least 2 hours to the nearest imaging treatment hospital. how they did this was it was a retrospective review of reports from Ski Patrol for several years. The only problem with the reports is they did not have a lot of emphasis on quality of reports when they're doing this. So that evidently has since been addressed. So from November of 2017 through March 2020, they searched through their reports for shoulder injury that they could pretty much narrow down to a shoulder dislocation. And that's how they included the information. And then from there, they started weeding out if it's spontaneously reduced before their intervention, fractures, that they any suspicion of a fracture, they were not going to fiddle with and cause more injury. If the patient refused relocation by non-medical, I imagine some people might be questioning on that one, when just send me to the hospital. If they had a more advanced provider there who was able to give IV or IM analgesia, they excluded this. For this review, when they're talking about analgesia, they're talking about specifically ibuprofen or Tylenol or nitrous oxide, which do love for the patient's self-administration. They just hold the mask to, and if they hit a little too much, the mask's going to fall away. And I believe there's another one that I didn't fit into memory that they were using more common, as it was recently more available in Canada. Incomplete documentation was an exclusion criteria. And if they happen to have a more advanced healthcare provider who did the reduction, that was excluded. And if the age was less than 16 or over 50, they excluded. Shocker, 25-year-old males were the most frequent victims. They lumped in the females with the males because they had not a great enough population of ladies who dislocated their shoulders to have what they felt to be statistically significant data. So they lumped men with men. And based on reduced and successful, they had a significant amount of success. There was methoxyfluorine. I'm not familiar with, but evidently they were happy with the results and inhaled. So how went about doing this, recruiting ski patrollers who did not have loosely termed medical training, was experienced ski patrollers. Here we have where they had more training, they were not included. So first, the ski patrollers who were aged enough, three or more years of experience, they were sent through a anatomy course to become familiar with the shoulder anatomy before even thinking about this. They were then sent out with a provider to do shoulder reductions, assisting wise or observationally, and then they were supervised in performing reductions. And this is all during the training aspect before they're cut loose to go do this independently. All these patients were removed from the field on the slope to where they could be adequately exposed and examined in a slightly less stressful environment, as the side of a hill with people coming down and skiing right for you because you're wearing orange. Let's see. The limitation of this was, as they are in a ski resort, they don't have imaging available. How they went to this was just a kind of a flow chart. Here's the age inclusion exclusion criteria, and if they found the physical findings they were looking for, and as long as they did not suspect a fracture, they would document before and after the neurological exam and then perform either the Cunningham or the Ferris technique, which isn't so much a traction as a, what they call it, biomechanical and relaxation to coax the shoulder back in. And here we're talking about the analgesia when they're nitrous oxide, more in the Cunningham. This is how they were taught to reduce it. And I had not seen this before, and I'm very excited because with the, as we pointed out, the lack of staffing and lack of staffing to help with procedural sedation, this not requiring so much sedation for a reduction. I had not read up much about before this. The Cunningham technique was their more favored approach, which they use for, I want to say, at least 2/3, if not 3/4 of reductions. And they also use the Fares technique, evidently a few times. Cunningham technique was more used, I guess, for the lack of movement, lack of walking around, and they could sit and face, whereas this required more flat surface and more area. They're pointing out that documentation on, as they term, non-medical providers doing this procedure had not been done before, and it was not in the scope of more or less non-medical ski patrollers in Canada. So the point was to, with supervision, with training, to put this into their scope and document it and dispel the thoughts of they would be causing harm. They did not have access to hospital records to follow up on these. All the patients were encouraged to give follow up afterwards. And that was just a great quote. I remember the difference between screwing around in science is they wrote down the results. Questions, thoughts?
Oh, I'll start off. I think it's great that you brought this article up. I thought it's a good article to really talk about. Can people actually train non-medical people to reduce shoulders? And the answer is yes. Especially for individuals that are out in the field. I will tell you that I use a little bit different method myself. I usually will train all my rangers that work at Great Basin National Park or rangers that worked at Guadalupe Mountains National Park, the Stimson method, which was basically lie them on a log or lie them on a rock, let the arm hang down, and then co-band or duct tape a couple of water bottles to their arm, and then leave them alone. It's never failed me if I can get to the person within about 30 to 40 minutes of them dislocating. And I think one of the general things to remember about the shoulder is that the longer you leave the shoulder dislocated, the longer it's going to take you to put it back in. The more those muscles contract and the more difficult it gets. And you'll be surprised. You'll get a very, a very small, petite little person who you think, I have, my palm is bigger than this person's deltoid. I should be able to pop this back in. That person will be the hardest reduction you've ever seen in your life. Just because if you leave it in there for a longer time, those muscles will just spasm down and it's difficult. So regardless of what technique you like to use, learn one or two of them. I think it's always an important thing. It's what I tell my fellows and my residents, that learn a couple of techniques that you're really comfortable with. And then if you like those, and every year you can add a different technique to your reduction armamentarium. But I think some take homes there, reducing a shoulder is important. I think it's important for every healthcare provider to learn how to do it, because it's going to happen to you, especially ones that go out in the wilderness. And being able to reduce a shoulder in the wilderness is probably one of the most satisfying things you'll ever do, because you take someone who is really in pain and can't move to someone who can self-extricate, right? You basically just swallow their arm back in against their body and away you go. Usually I'll put them in a sling position and they can walk out versus beforehand when every step was just excruciating. I'm glad you brought up the Cunningham version or Cunningham method of doing that. When I was kind of in training, we call that the massage technique. which kind of always got eyes rolling at people at the time. I personally, I don't know if Dr. Eggers has had a lot of luck with that, but I've tried it a few times to try and if I could massage the shoulder back in, and it's never worked on me, worked for me, but I know a couple of my partners that they swear by it, and it's their way to go. But I think overall, if you learn a couple of good techniques, that's going to save you. And you will see these. You will see these. I'll stop there and let Dr. Eggers step in if he wants to say a few words.
Yeah. So my experience, I've only actually reduced a few shoulders myself because usually by the time I'm called, it's because the ER has failed. And so I'm getting it when it's like an hour and a half out. And so the ones that I've reduced, I haven't used a technique. We just like spend 30 minutes doing everything we can. So in terms of like which techniques are the best, I don't have personal experience in that. What I can tell you is from the surgical side, seeing the sequelae from shoulder problems. And what I'll say is if you come up to somebody with a shoulder injury and you want to help, the first question you're going to ask is, can I make this better? The second question you're going to ask is, am I going to make this worse? And what I'll say is for somebody between the age of 16 and 50, if you can identify a shoulder dislocation, you're almost guaranteed not to make it worse if you use a standard technique. You'll almost certainly make it better. It's worth at least trying. One thing that I thought was really helpful that they said in here that answers the question of will I make this worse is, I think it was on page 447, when they said that the frequency of fractures associated with dislocation is as high as 30%. But the thing to remember is that that is any bony abnormality. So if you get a Hill-Sachs lesion, which is just a dent, I wouldn't even consider it a fracture. Or even a bony Bankart lesion, which is just a chip off the glenoid. Those are lumped into that 30% number, but they have no relevance in terms of how you're going to reduce it, and maybe even no relevance in how it's going to be acutely managed. So the answer to me is you're probably not going to make anything worse. Now, if it's somebody over 50, then you're more likely to have a fracture. In fact, I just had a patient had the most shattered proximal humerus fracture dislocation I've ever seen. And she fell at a gym and there was a nurse there who said, oh, it's a shoulder dislocation, and pulled on it. Now, I don't know if it actually made it worse or not, but it sure hurt the patient like crazy. So the age that they put in there, I'm glad they did that age exclusion criteria because that's very reasonable. Less than 16 years old, you're more likely to have a proximal humeral physeal injury. Over 50, it's more likely to be a proximal humerus fracture, not a dislocation. But especially in males in that 16 to 50 year old range, if it's a shoulder injury and you get the square shoulder, sulcus sign, all of that, it's a dislocation. It's worth putting it back in.
I just wanted to add that I started out thinking that pure muscle would get all these shoulders back in. I definitely realized over the years, it's definitely finesse and technique. I remember once I pulled so hard, I moved the bed that was locked. So you don't need to do that. Just gentle technique. I always have we're talking ER, not in the field, but imagine the anatomy while you're doing it. And if you have the ability, have the x-ray on the screen in the room while you're doing it. But in the field, you're just going to be doing what is, you know, play the statistical odds here. It's most likely going to be anterior, right? But yeah, it's all technique. And there are definitely ways the fares at Cunningham. If you put somebody prone, you do scapular manipulation. I've been remarkably successful with just some mild traction and some internal external rotation. Definitely finesse, coach them through it. And I remember in early residency, all of us thought the same thing, just pull on it. And then one of our attendings learned the Cunningham technique and was trying that. And he's this very verbose, very traditionally Greek guy, and just loves to teach and talk. And we just called it, he annoyed it into place. We would just say he went in there and he just annoyed the person so much that their shoulder just reduced. But apparently just gentle, and you'll be surprisingly successful.
Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned that, because that is something that can make it worse, is too much traction in the wrong way. And I like to tell people that reductions are like rock climbing. It's not about brute strength. It's more about technique. And you can make up for a lack of brute strength with good technique. And you can't just muscle your way up the wall, and you can't just muscle your way through a reduction. You have to do it the right way.
Unfortunately, I'm going to have to head out. We've got quite a few people on, luckily, helping. So Carver is our fellow. He's going to be kind of proctoring from here on out. Thanks, everybody. I'm going to watch the video and kind of see what I missed. So enjoy the rest. I'm going to be heading into the ER. So have a good night.
You too.
Night. So who was the third presenter who's going to take a crack at this third article? And I've got some points we could talk about too.
I was. So just a heads up, there was a bit of a miscommunication and I did the same article as Drew. So, but I did read the other systematic review. So I'm going to take a crack at presenting that if that's good with all of you.
Perfect.
So bear with me. I'll kind of go verbally, and I've also got it pulled up on internet, so I can pull up the article here. All right, can everyone see this? Perfect. So this was an article basically out of the Chinese Journal of Traumatology. It was looking at systematic review of different pre-hospital shoulder reduction techniques. The main reason they were kind of looking at this is looking at management and trying to figure out the risk of acute complications in pre-hospital, and looking at different techniques and trying to figure out which has the highest success rate and the lowest complication rate. So we talked a bit about the background of shoulder dislocation with Drew's article coming out of Canada. So they do talk a little bit about how it's a younger population that's often exposed to this injury, that it's pretty common. Anterior shoulder dislocations are about 90% of total shoulder dislocations. And it's an incidence that's pretty high within the general population, of about 1.7%. And they just mentioned that the majority are managed within the emergency department, but enough happen in outside activities, as we've talked about, that pre-hospital management is something good to look into, especially since there doesn't really exist a standard of care or best practice at this point. So basically their main goal was looking at the risk of acute complications. And then their secondary analysis or endpoint was looking at the highest success rate here. So they looked at quite a few articles. They went through about 298 total, read through 40, and then ended up looking at 4 for their quantitative meta-analysis. And their inclusion-exclusion criteria, basically what they were looking at was study quality, and then looking at their primary goal of management of acute anterior shoulder dislocation. Anything that had to do with intrinsic shoulder instability was excluded from the study analysis. And then they looked through the different endpoints, looking at the design demographics, where the reduction took place, the technique, success rates, complications, analgesia use, which we'll talk about, and then recurrence rates and surgical intervention rates. So basically looking through their different conclusions from the studies, they looked at 4 different ones, one from 2015, having to do with pre-hospital stations in Germany and Austria. This was basically looking at, there's no immediate or obvious contraindication for emergency physicians to reduce in the pre-hospital environment. And then They looked at another DIDI 2010, was a retrospective cohort. And this was looking at the success rate of about 72%, no sedation or trained medical professionals on scene. Seidenberger was out of Germany and Austria. This was looking at basically the factors that are associated with successful shoulder reduction, and the skill level, specialty type helped determine the successful reduction. And then Boker-Billman, I thought, was interesting. This was looking at a novel technique that we can look at really quickly. And this was kind of seeing which was the most effective. This had actually a pretty high efficacy rate of about 95%. So they did notice that the population was generally pretty young. A total of 181 patients were included, and the mean age was about 40 years old. Activities included climbing, kayaking, mountain biking, skiing. And then the first attempt success rate for these studies ranged anywhere from 54 to 95%. I thought it was kind of interesting. They did mention that they said no acute complications were observed, but they really didn't have a chance to follow up on operative intervention, long-term complications, or return to sport phase. So that was kind of a data point that was missing from these studies. And then Seidenberger, one of the German and Austrian studies, did show that 9% of patients with ASD did have some neural involvement. They mentioned several other techniques. The Hippocratic maneuver, which to my understanding involves traction with a foot placed in the armpit and then basically lateral movement, pull, traction placed on the upper extremity. They had self-reduction, the external rotation maneuver, Stimson's, which I think Dr. Eggers and Dr. Islis could talk about that. And then the Boker-Billman technique, which I'm going to switch here. Can you all see this screen now? This basically involved flexion at the elbow, followed by shoulder flexion, followed by adduction, followed by internal rotation. And then basically applying at that very end a constant internal rotation pressure to overcome the resistance. And that one I thought was interesting since they reported a very high success rate in that case of about 95%. And we can see here some of the other techniques that were used. We had Helfin, Hippocratic, scapular manipulation, self-reduction. This was the one that was looking at pre-hospital practice. This had about a 54% success rate, analgesia use of about 96%, and then neurologic deficit of about 10%, which did improve following reduction. DIDI showed about 72% with the external rotation maneuver, Stimson's, and traction counter traction. Seidenberger had about a 70% with Hippocratic. And then they also showed a good neurologic complication improvement rate. And interestingly, the Boker-Billman had that 95% with a 0% rate of analgesia use. So showed pretty good outcomes, which I thought was interesting there. That with that technique, they had low analgesia, but one of the highest first reduction attempt rates. And then just moving on from there, they did talk a little bit about analgesia. They used, in some cases, one drug therapy, a dose of fentanyl. In some, they used midazolam, ketamine, or fentanyl. And then in some, they used midazolam, ketamine, and fentanyl as their procedural sedation. So without diving too much into the discussion, since I didn't spend too much time looking over this article, but they did discuss kind of some of the complication rates especially some of the complication rates associated with the Hippocratic technique, as well as the Stimson's technique, which I think Dr. Eggers and Dr. Islas will be able to elaborate a lot more on that. They also talked about concomitant fractures, and basically that these are pretty low prevalence among patients younger than 40 years. And then also showed that analgesia is not always required for the successful reduction of these shoulder reduction or of these techniques. And then they do mention briefly that early pre-hospital reduction may help with recurrence rates and may have a positive impact on a return of strength and joint movement, which could help in kind of long-term outcomes and reducing healthcare associated costs. So again, thanks for letting me take a crack at presenting that despite the misunderstanding with the articles. And I'll open it up to questions and more discussion now.
Thank you very much. Yeah, one thing I thought was very interesting was the Hippocratic was definitely the most utilized in the pre-hospital and hospital setting, but it did have a higher rate of complications. And then the Stimson and the newer Boker Billman had a higher success rate, it seemed like, of 72 and 94 with lower complications, although there was some weaknesses to those studies.
Yeah, speaking of weaknesses to the studies, I think I would have preferred this to have been a review article, not a meta-analysis. I don't think that a meta-analysis in this case, the studies they used weren't really amenable to that design. You know, garbage in, garbage out, you have to look at the studies that go in. And if you look at table two, when you see the study location, the first study, Helfen, was 16 pre-hospital rescue stations. The Diddy study, and I didn't read any of the studies, I probably should have, and I want to dig into more, but the study location from Diddy was an online wilderness sports forum. So basically they looked back and saw what people were talking about on the internet. And then Siedenberger was 16 pre-hospital rescue stations. So you can see none of these are done in like academic ERs with orthopedic department follow-up. So in terms of how accurately these studies can even assess for post-reduction complications, I would say is impossible based on the studies to say. So what I'm trying to say is from this article, we can't conclude that there's no post-reduction sequelae. Doesn't mean there is, it just means that this article can't show it. All studies reported zero immediate complications, but the studies couldn't because they didn't follow up with the orthopedic surgeons who treated them post-operatively, I mean post-reduction, if that makes sense. So just kind of watch for that when you're looking, and that's more of a overarching how to critically evaluate literature. I like the article. I thought it was good. I wish they'd done it more as a, this is what the studies show, rather than actually trying to pool the data, because I don't think the data was good enough to pool.
That's a good point. I've got a little video of the Stimson method if you want to see that. Hopefully the audio will work this time. Can you guys hear that? No? All right. I'll just copy and paste it into chat then. You guys can look at it on your own. And I didn't find any video
You want to show that video, I can probably talk you through it.
Okay, sure.
All right, so the idea is that you want to have some counter traction. And obviously this is in an ER. So the idea here, you move the patient over so that their arm is hanging off of something. And I've done this actually off of a large log, and I've duct taped water bottles to the forearm. But notice how he's kind of doing it. I will put the strap on the back end of the hand. You don't want them grabbing onto anything. And then he's going the extra mile and kind of doing a little bit of scapular manipulation and trying to get the patient to relax. And so the way you see they reduce that way, probably talking about neural intactness. They showed a wide view, which was out. Wide view, you want to have the head of the humerus in the intersection of the Y, and showing that that's where it's supposed to be. So that's a wide view. So that's in, because if you notice the intersection of the Y basically is kind of within the head of the humerus. I think, I don't know if Dr. Egers agrees with me, sir, concur.
I would say that if all you can get is the Y view, it can probably show you that it's in. But our dogma in orthopedics is you can never confirm a reduced shoulder without an axillary view.
Right.
So that would also be my take home for everybody, especially if you're going to be in primary care or ER. Before you call the orthopedic surgeon, make sure there's an axillary view of the shoulder, because that's the only way you can actually confirm that it is in fact dislocated or reduced. But the Y view is a good secondary if you can't get one.
So I've done that Stimson method many times, but I kind of am an odd bird because I usually see the dislocation happen. So it's right then and there. I go in there, I do the maneuver, and it pops back in. And I like doing them, especially on my bigger athletes. I had an athlete that's now playing in the NBA, and his deltoid's the size of my head. So there's no way that I was going to be able to pull on that and get it to go anywhere. But I did the Stimson method, and I think kind of something that maybe we alluded to as well is that when you have someone that's dislocated, kind of putting on that soothing radio voice that you have. And, you know, I had an attendee that used to talk about, you have to hypnotize them, right? Get them to relax and trust you and be able to do that. So you need to put that voice on and say, it's going to be all right. We're going to be good. Just kind of relax. Let me have it. Let it go. You know, you need to kind of really get that, you know, next up on WBRU is we're going to be playing blah, 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 blah. You really need to have that nice soothing sort of eye contact, like, trust me, I'm a trained physician, kind of thing. It really makes a big difference. And being able to do that with a Stimson method, it's kind of easy because the patient's laying there and you can kind of sit there and sort of massage your shoulder, massage the deltoid and the traps a little bit of the biceps, just to get them to feel better. And all of a sudden, boom, pops back in. But yeah, I agree. I think really and truly you need to find the method that works best for you, that you feel most comfortable with. And I think on the appropriate patient, which is usually the patient you'll find in the wilderness, maybe not all the time, but a lot of the times, that 16 to 4 to 50 year old male, you should try it, you know, put it in. One thing we talked about too, is that we didn't talk about, I get this a lot, actually, when I'm out in the wilderness, the shoulder dislocations, oftentimes on the field, I see this, they come in and their arms sort of in the sling position, but for some reason out in the parks, I end up with this. Oftentimes you get guys running around a park like this, they won't put their arm down because it's dislocated. And you can imagine they're hitting every darn thing that exists out there, trees, you know, overhanging bushes, vines, trash cans, whatever it is, they're running into it. So, you know, taking this arm and being able to put it down, getting it back into place, makes them so much more, you know, able to extricate themselves. So, you know, my two cents.
And there weren't any really good videos on the Bokar-Billman method. So if anyone's interested in that, that might be a good project to do, is make a little video of that method. Any other questions, comments?
I did have a question about kind of pre-hospital procedural sedation for shoulder dislocation reduction. So in this study, they mentioned they used the Versed ketamine and fentanyl sometimes. I know the one Drew presented, they talked more about methoxyfluorine, not available in the US, but also like nitrous oxide, ibuprofen, Tylenol. What recommendations would you have for kind of managing these in the wilderness?
You know, again, your first and foremost, the best method of analgesia is going to be just getting to relax and using that radio voice, hypnotizing them, look them in the eye, right? That's your go-to. Analgesia in the wilderness, you know, I will admit, I don't carry a whole bunch of stuff. I don't carry things that I think people are going to rummage through my backpack for. you know, the most interesting and kind of strange athlete to work with are climbers. If they want something, they're going to get it. I can't tell you how many times I've had, you know, hey, Doc, I'm going to be climbing this weekend. Can I have my Viagra? And it's just like, no, you know, it's not going to happen that way. They're very motivated individuals. So they'll go after it if they think it's there. So oftentimes, you know, the only thing I'll have with me might be a little bit of lidocaine. And I'll tell you that, and I don't know, Dr. Eggers might want to have a different opinion on this one, but it's the easiest shoulder injection you'll ever do is in a dislocated shoulder, right? And if they're really, I can't get it back in, I'll put a little lidocaine into the now vacated shoulder joint and then give it a couple minutes and then boop, usually pops right back in. But I won't do much more than that. And true, you have to be careful. If you tried to put it back in and it won't go back in, chances are there's a reason why it won't go back in. So you need to be kind of careful. You get three shots, at least in my group and like what I teach my fellows, is you get three chances. If it takes you more than three chances to put something back in, something is wrong. You know, one, you didn't pull hard enough. Two, your technique's wrong. Three, now you have everything set up and you should be able to pop it back in. And if it takes you more than that, stop.
Yeah, that's all perfect. And I agree with the intra-articular block. As long as you stay lateral to the coracoid, you're safe. And yeah, it's a big space. So it's going to be hard to miss. I agree. Thanks, Dr. Islas. That was perfect.
Any other final thoughts? I'm going to stop the recording now.